Thanks. It really is an honor to be invited to give this talk by the Walter Roberts talk. I only met him very briefly at the lunch table at NCAR before I worked there one time. And I don't think we talk science, but he came off as such a warm, warm person that he was just an amazing example of a great scientist that had a lot of personality. So I could never fill his shoes, but I can try to honor it by not screwing up this talk. So I want to thank John Katzenberger, James, Michael, Brian, everybody else that's helped us have this meeting this week. It's already a fantastic meeting. We're only 2 days into it. We're sort of mentally exhausted already, at least I am. So I will try not to marble my words today. I want to thank you all for coming. Why would people in Aspen come want us to talk about or hear talk about coral reefs? I don't know, but I really appreciate it. I think it's an escape, and it's escape, I guess.
That's a canary in the coal mine.
that's a good point. Canary in the coal mine. A lot of people have said that about coral reefs. But let's get started. I'm going to just give you a brief overview of coral reefs, what they are, and I'm really going to focus on climate change impacts. Coral reefs are impacted by a lot of things, but I'm going to focus on climate change and just try to step you through an understanding of how they're being impacted and what we can do about it in the future. So coral reefs, a lot of people, when I put this slide up, go, oh my God, there's a lot of reefs out there. There's a lot more reefs than I thought there were. Part of the reason is these dots are really fat. But there is a big distribution of reefs in the Caribbean and the Eastern Pacific, off of Africa. A lot of people don't know about these reefs in here, the Red Sea, and of course the Indo-Pacific and Australia. So they're everywhere. There are not a lot of them in terms of volume or space. You could take all of these reefs and put them, God forbid, in Texas. They would all fit in Texas. But I can guarantee that the real estate value of these reefs is a lot higher than they are in Texas. They're more like Aspen real estate value. So what are they? So this is a picture of the Great Barrier Reef, and I did a lot of work a little bit south of there. This is northern part of the Great Barrier Reef here, and this is an amazing ecosystem because you can see it from the space shuttle. Since, in fact, that was one of the things one of the space shuttle astronauts said, is like, I can see the reefs from up here, right? And so they got a lot of play after those space flights, and if you blow it up, you can see they're pretty intricate. They're big, you know? They're big geologic structures. These reefs were built by the organisms, built by the coral reefs, just huge amounts of calcium carbonate, and they provide an amazing habitat for biodiversity and a lot of the marine life as we know it in these shallow shelves. If you fly out over on, they're just gorgeous. How many people in here have been on a coral reef? And how many people have scuba dived and gotten underwater? That's great. So you know as much as I do then. So I'll just do a review. Okay, so this is the major reef-building coral in the Caribbean, Acropora palmata, also called the elkhorn coral. So three things: pollution, direct exploitation by humans, and climate change. Those are the three things that are really impacting reefs. I'm not going to go over all of these things here. I'm really going to concentrate on climate change issues. So you guys, I bet you guys have seen this figure before, because I've seen it probably 100 times. This is a brief diagram showing why CO2 is rising in the atmosphere. So it's due to deforestation primarily, and fossil fuel burning and a few other activities. So this carbon goes into the atmosphere, and it doesn't all stay in the atmosphere, about half of it does. And the rest of it is partitioned between uptake of the biosphere and then into the ocean. So most people don't think about the ocean. The ocean is doing us a great favor. Out of all the CO2 we put in the atmosphere, it soaks up about a quarter of it. That's a really nice thing. Thank you, oceans, right? So the problem is it does affect the oceans. So we have rising CO2 in the atmosphere. These are carbon dioxide molecules. And there are, when we add CO2 molecules in the atmosphere, that increases the pressure. And I'm kind of corny about my talks, so I tend to put music in them. It's a theme song for rising pressure in the atmosphere. So for people that scuba dived and were tested on this on your exam, you know that Henry's Law says that when you add pressure to the to a volume, you drive more of that into the liquid that's in equilibrium with it. So what happens? We have two things that happen that can affect the ocean. We've got warming, atmospheric warming, and then that causes, transfers some of that heat into the ocean and it causes ocean warming. And then some of those molecules are absorbed by the ocean itself and that changes the chemistry. So again, two things I'll talk about primarily, rising temperature, and this is from the latest IPCC report that many people in here worked on. This is kind of like two different scenarios. This is the favorable scenario, maybe you call that the Al Gore scenario. And then we have, you know, what we hope for, and then we have the where we're headed scenario, and you can pick your favorite person. This is the where we're headed scenario. So we're looking at those kind of choices when we look at climate change. And when we look at the average pH of the ocean, this is going in the opposite direction. This is pH. We start off, actually it was 8.2 or a little bit higher during the pre-industrial period. We're starting at about 1950. The gray line is, you know, the record. And these are the predictions from the models. And we see sort of the same thing. We've got the, you know, what we hope for and where we're headed. So this is, for pH, this is a dangerous pH for the oceans. That's my opinion, but this is, we know from research now that that is not where we want to go in terms of coral reefs. So let's talk about coral bleaching first. Coral bleaching, this is some wonderful photos from the Catlin Sea View Survey. Coral reefs, I did not take these myself, but they allowed me to show them to you. So I'll talk a little bit about coral bleaching. And I think I'll pass one of these around. This is a coral skeleton, if you guys haven't seen these things. It is, just to tell you what a coral is, it's an animal, it's not a plant. And it is like an anemone that grows colonially upside down, as all connected together, and they secrete these beautiful calcium carbonate skeletons. Calcium carbonate is, people call it lime, they call it aragonite, calcite. So have it up here in the hills in certain places. So it's a beautiful material that they secrete, and that's what builds the reefs. That tissue that they have also has these microbes in it, these algae that do photosynthesis. And the reason these corals can grow so quickly is because they can use sun energy to get a lot of energy. If that would be a real revolution if we could do that to our own skin, where we'd sunbathe, then we wouldn't have to eat. We'd solve the food crisis. But we haven't been able to do that yet. They've done it very successfully and have been around for a long time because of it. This is an unbleached coral. It's healthy. It's nice and dark. All the algae are in the tissues. This is a recently bleached coral. It's white just like that skeleton, but it's still alive. If the tissue just has lost all its color and you're looking straight through the tissue, which is transparent to the white skeleton. So this is that's a phenomenon of coral bleaching. It's been increasing in frequency and intensity. We never knew these things really happened, these bleaching events ever happened before. I've been working on coral reef stuff since about 1975, and we rarely talked about it, but now it's gotten very frequent, particularly during periods where we have excess heat in the surface ocean, like in El Nino years. 1997, 98, 30% of the reefs worldwide experienced bleaching. And a lot of them died. Not all of them, they can recover, but the ones that were most severely bleached died. Some scientists think that the bleaching frequency with the current increase in temperature, that most reefs won't make it by the middle of the century. That's the most extreme case. Keep in mind, there are a lot of different types of corals on reefs. There's more coral species on reefs than you have probably plants out here, okay? So they all have different responses. Just like, and then even within an individual species, if you look at the pine bark beetle infestations, not all the trees get hit. Some of them are better than others at tolerating that kind of infection. So, but it is if we, you know, looked at it in the direst way, that's what we would see.
And this is primarily from pH, not from temperature.
No, this here is from temperature. Coral bleaching is caused by water's getting too warm. But I'm glad you brought that up because I didn't explain that. So when the temperatures, they can handle temperatures going up and down all year long, but they have a maximum temperature that they can handle. And it depends on where they live. Bahamas, or let's say in Bermuda, that temperature is around 28 degrees centigrade. In the Red Sea, it's about 36 degrees centigrade. But once those temperatures start going above that, then we have a heat stress. This is the way we calculate heat stress. NOAA developed this. It's called degree heating week. It's a dosage of excess temperature. So week one, if you have 1 degree centigrade above your normal maximum temperature, you start accumulating stress. Week two, you know, suppose it was 2 degrees above, you got even more stress, and so on. And it accumulates over a 12-week period. And that's how we measure the stress that corals are feeling. Again, the top one is an unbleached coral, and the bottom one is a bleached coral. So this, anybody can get this off the web. They've got great movies as well. This is the NOAA predictions. I pulled this off last night. This is a picture of heat stress. This is increasing heat stress here. And this is the accumulation of heat over the last 12 weeks shown in this map. So you can see that some places off of the Baja and the Eastern Pacific, any of the reefs in the Panama, probably experiencing some bleaching. And there's a little place right here off the Keys where NOAA people have sent out a warning and said, let's see if there's any bleaching out there. It's not as severe in the Keys, but this is the place I would worry about right now. So this is how we predict it. If you start getting mild bleaching in these green areas, once you get over 8, you get a little more bleaching. When you get into this zone, it's almost certain you're going to see some bleaching. Over the last 20 years, the coral reefs have bleached, experienced severe bleaching in every ocean. This is the percentage of reefs that have experienced coral bleaching. It hasn't been that much here in the Indo-Pacific, but we're not sure about that number because we don't have a lot of people observing that. We have a lot in the Eastern Pacific, mostly due to big El Nino events, and a considerable amount in the Caribbean. But quite a few reefs are experiencing bleaching. Ocean acidification, that's the next part. That's the direct consequence of CO2 being taken up by the ocean. And so you don't have to believe much, go much beyond a bottle of carbonated water to understand that the pH goes down when you add CO2 to it. So I'm going to give you a little cartoon chemistry so you can understand how this works. So we've got CO2 rising in the atmosphere. When that CO2, the carbon dioxide, combines with water, you form a compound called carbonic acid. That right there tells you that that's going to change or lower the pH. But that carbonic acid is a weak acid, and it dissociates very quickly, pulls apart very quickly into a hydrogen ion is shed, and that leaves behind bicarbonate. And then that hydrogen ion, there's a little bit of carbonate out here too. So carbon can exist as carbonate, or carbon can exist as carbon dioxide, bicarbonate, or carbonate in the ocean. And that hydrogen ion combines with carbonate to form more bicarbonate. So a lot of people say, if you're adding carbon in the ocean, why don't you get more carbonate? It's because when you add carbon to the ocean, you actually shift the chemistry around to actually pull out that carbonate or combine it with hydrogen. The reason this is important is because in the ocean we have a ton of bicarbonate, and we don't have a lot of carbonate. Carbonate is what organisms use, calcium carbonate, to build their shells. So they're looking for that molecule. And so when we have this process happen, well, you're taking some of that carbonate and you're making more bicarbonate. And that means you have less in the ocean for building shells. So that's about as simple as I can make that, but that's how it works. And just to sort of show you the pH scale, we have high values of pH, it means it's alkaline. Low values of pH, it means it's more acidic. The ocean seawater is right here. It's a pretty constant value, and it stays pretty constant. There's all these feedbacks in check over geologic history to try to keep it constant. Our blood is right here. This is, I put this up here just to say, well, our blood, we have to maintain a very narrow pH range. If your pH range of your blood goes out of whack, then the biochemistry of your blood can cause problems elsewhere in your body. So our body does a lot of work to keep our pH fairly constant too. Now this is like the Richter scale. So when you have a pH that's really high, you have very, very little hydrogen ions in there, very little acidity. But it's a 10 times, for every one unit pH change, you got 10 times as much hydrogen ions. So it's not a strictly linear scale. And so a lot of people ask me that, what is the pH of beer? And then I thought, oh my God, this is aspen. Wine is right there. Okay, so just to go over this, I'm sorry I take a lot of time with this, but I'll get over it soon. This just shows you, again, these different forms of carbonate in the ocean. And if we look at them broken up right here, we have a lot of bicarbonate to start with. This is a pre-industrial concentration before we started burning fossil fuels. And this is the carbonate, and that's the dissolved carbon dioxide. We can see that as we change that value, you see a big change. Now, so the reason I do this is because I want you to think of pH as a suite of shifts. It's not just one thing that happens. I'm going to focus on this carbonate ion today, but there's a lot of things that happen. For one, the top ones, plants like this. This is bicarbonate and carbon CO2 going up, and a lot of plants are actually fertilized by this in the ocean. Seagrasses really tend to like the extra CO2. The carbonate's going down, so a lot of organisms do not like this. There's been a lot of research on this, and there's definitely a problem with things that secrete calcium carbonate as the pH goes down and the carbonate ion goes down. And then there's a whole suite of things here, too, with the pH going down in terms of metabolism of organisms, their behavior, how they respond to predators. So the pH can have effects on them. So the effects on coral reef builders, I'm really just focusing on the corals. And I'm just going to give you the theme song for ocean acidification, because we know it affects the skeletons of corals and the bones of a lot of other things.
I'm bad to the bone. I'm bad to the bone. I'm bad to the bone.
So now you won't forget, right? Okay, so how do we know about ocean acidification impacts on ecosystems? So we struggled a long time. All the stuff we were doing, we're just plunking things for a while in beakers with lower pH and trying to figure out what's going on. And of course, nobody likes that. They're like, but that's not the real world. So scientists have discovered some places in Italy, not too bad a place either, Papua New Guinea, where there is volcanic activity under the substrate. And CO2 is bubbling up right through the sediments into these reef environments. So it's a natural way of looking at acidification. So, you know, it's exactly what we would do if we planned a big experiment in the field. So this is the one in Papua New Guinea. What they find, they have these big vent sites. And when you go on the reef outside the vent, you have normal pH conditions. And as you swim towards where these vents are, the pH just goes down. And so they have this natural gradient that they can look at. So this is what the reef looks like under normal conditions. The pH of about 8.05, we call that today's conditions. pH of 7.95, which we expect around the middle of the century, you start getting only a few species of corals left, and a lot of the biodiversity goes down. And then by the time you hit 7.8, and there's several sites that show exactly the same thing in different parts of the world, this is about the end of the century, you really lose a lot of corals. Your biodiversity goes down, your coral recruitment goes down. So the baby corals that are floating around in the water trying to settle can't settle successfully in those areas. And then another important thing is the erosion rates here. All the biological things that come in and start chewing down the reef, it's a lot easier for them to do that under those low pH conditions. That's just another example. So let's talk about this recruitment issue, the coral life cycle. So corals, like I said, are animals. These are the babies floating around. They're just, we call them planula, but we'll call them baby corals. They're floating around and they're in the water column. They can be in the water column for days to months, almost a full year. And when they sense a suitable substrate, usually through some sort of chemistry in the ocean, they will settle down and they start growing a single polyp. And then they grow into a mature, more mature polyp, and then to one that can actually reproduce again and form these gametes that can float around. So that's the life cycle of the coral. What's interesting, I think this is one of the most important things about the reefs, they like to settle on something. This is something called coral and algae. It looks like a coral, but it's not. It's formed by an algae, and it also secretes calcium carbonate. And corals love to settle on this stuff and start growing. Settle, attach themselves, and start growing. So this stuff is it's kind of like the neglected, important sister on the reef. Nobody pays that much attention to it, but it's very important. And so corals like to settle on it. This is some of that algae, and it's been, for this experiment, it was cultured in different pHs. These are the baby corals that have settled on it and started to grow right on that algae. So what happened in this experiment is they grew it in different pHs, and at the high pH they had a successful settlement of the corals here, but you can see it goes down as the pH goes down. So what happened? Was it something wrong with the coral larvae? No, it was the coral larvae were not affected by the pH, but we had fewer coral larvae settling. What happened was the algae were not producing the compounds that trigger the corals to settle. So if a coral, small baby coral, is swimming over this, or not swimming, floating over a reef, it doesn't smell that reef. And so it won't stop. It'll just stay in the water column. So this is probably going to reduce recruitment rates. The ones that do recruit, these are the tiny ones. They're starting to barely form their skeletons, right? If it's under low pH conditions, those skeletons are much more fragile and thin. And so this was another interesting thing. Once they settle, what is their survival rate? So this is under normal conditions without any fish in there. This is the interesting thing. The white is, you know, normal CO2, normal today's conditions. And then as we go here, we go in higher and higher CO2 conditions, lower and lower pH. So the dark is like future. This is today. So under normal conditions, we don't see much of a change in the survival of these things under control conditions without any fish under those three different pHs. So the corals aren't affected there until you start putting in fish. So you put a blenny in there, all of a sudden they're not surviving anymore. It's because it's wiggling around on the surface and breaking up these ones which were raised in the low pH water. They're more fragile. Same thing for the surgeon fish and really for the parrotfish. So the bottom line is that with ocean acidification, the corals are more fragile and fish become bulls in a china closet. Same thing with bioerosion. So reason why reefs are so important for supporting biodiversity is because they grow these big complex structures. There's lots of places for organisms to hide. It just supports a lot of niches for biodiversity. But there's a lot of stuff that chews it up right away. You got these things grazing on the reef. There's the bad boy parrotfish again. You got some echinoderms or sea urchins, things that like to drill into the reef, and then these microscopic things that like to drill into the reef. And there's been a couple studies showing that these things, these sponges, are much more effective, 30% increase in their bioerosion rates under future CO2 conditions. Same thing for the microbores. So what we're seeing is that not only are reefs, corals having a harder time finding the reefs and growing on the reefs, But the reefs are actually dissolving and eroding away faster. So the big issue here is that the reefs will have a harder time maintaining themselves and supporting biodiversity and protecting shorelines and fisheries and everything else. So it's depressing, and most of you, if you wanted to, you know, theme song would be something like this. So those are real headlines, kind of depressing. I don't like that one. I don't like that theme song, so I'm going to go with this one. And I think we can do that too. There's a lot we can do. So, you know, I'm not a doomsdayer in my talks. I think the situation is bad, but I think we will slow down CO2 emissions eventually. We're taking our time doing it, but I think we will do it. In the meantime, we need to find ways to help these ecosystems make it through. So let's talk about some of those things. We need to plan for the future. A lot of the work I've been doing lately is with the Nature Conservancy. One of the first things that they do is you just eliminate other stressors on reefs. So stop the destructive fishing, you know, do whatever you can to eliminate these kind of stressors. I hope you don't do that. People damage on reefs, anchor damage, invasive species. How many people have seen this lionfish in the Caribbean? Yeah, so that can have a big impact on reefs, and they're really working hard to get rid of that. The work that I do is modeling, so I don't even get in the water anymore, very rarely. Mostly I do it from my computer, and we're working with high-resolution modeling. This is the Indonesia region. This is Northern Australia, Papua New Guinea, Borneo, Malaysia, and Indonesia. This is the richest coral reefs in this orange area here. And the modeling that we do is in this area here. We're using that model to help the Nature Conservancy find the best places to put their efforts to conserve the reefs. So how do we find what those areas are? So one of the things, I just want to show you a few pictures in the coral triangle. This is from my colleague Rod Salm at the Nature Conservancy. These corals in these areas, some of these areas, are just huge. They're probably hundreds of years old. They're amazing. And this is not a retouch photo. They are amazingly beautiful, colorful, healthy systems. So as opposed to what we see in a lot of the Caribbean reefs, there are still very good reefs in the Pacific and in the Pacific, and we can learn a lot about how to save those reefs by combining things like modeling and on-the-ground work. So these pink areas here are all the reefs plotted on the map. When I was first starting my PhD, we didn't even know where the reefs were. So we've come a long way in just actually finding them and mapping them. And this is what the model looks like. Earlier I mentioned degree heating weeks, which is a measure of heat stress, where low values are low heat, low stress, and high values are high heat stress. And this is just about a 50-year run of, let's see if I can get this to go. This is about a 50-year run of that heat stress, and there are a few years that are bad. You can see sort of the seasonal nature of this moving up and down with the sun. It's starting in about 1960, and we're at 1970 now. The big year you want to look at is 97, 98. That was the year where probably about 30% of the reefs here were affected by coral bleaching. And we're using this to analyze this and find out what were the exact conditions that led to this event. Is it a really unusual event? Is it something we can expect in the future? And are there areas where you don't see much heat stress? You don't see much heat stress here. You don't see much heat stress in here. So there's a few areas which, over this whole period of time, have escaped, for one reason or another, that heat stress. And so 97, 98's coming up. And I wanted to put this to the music, "It's Too Hot Baby," but I couldn't find that song.
How does this relate
That's
to
the big, it's the big one. That was the El Nino. Actually, in this part of the world, it's the La Niñas that are bad for the reefs, not the El Ninos. So once we identify some of these regions, the other thing, going back to that coral life cycle, these corals do an amazing thing. One is they, let's see if I can get this to go. There it is. So this is a mass coral spawning event on the flower gardens off of Texas coast. And this is an amazing thing to see. These things, one night of the year or just a few nights of the year, they all spawn at once, and there's just sperm and semen everywhere. And I'm not sure if you really want to be in there, but it is very interesting. All the other organisms know this is happening. They're all feeding on this stuff and going crazy. And once, you know, this spawning event happens, it leads to these big slicks in the ocean. So this is big slick of all these coral, this big orgy event out here in the ocean. And it happened, and it's important to do that. To spawn all at one night, it guarantees fertilization success. If you spawn one night and your girlfriend spawns the other night, their eggs and they're just not going to find each other. So there's a reason to do that. So what we do is we use the model to find places. If a reef gets hit, suppose all the corals die, they can recover. They can recover because the larvae, as I said, they float around and they can find new reefs. So we're trying to identify those reefs that are really important as sources of larvae and sinks of larvae. And so this is just a video of one of those animations. And I put it to Bob Marley music. So you can see these things being moved around by the currents. And we're using this to study how climate change will change those currents as well. You can see some of these areas, the areas of highest biodiversity, have the most mixing of these different regions. And it's really telling. We're starting over again. This is just one other way that we're trying to take this into the future, these models into the future, and understand what's going to happen in terms of their ability. Do they get hit by climate change issues, and can they recover through this larval reseeding? Another thing I think is really on the horizon that's very hopeful is reef restoration. And this was originally shunned. People said this will never work, it doesn't work, it fails, but they're really getting a handle on it now, and you can see they're planting some of the, they usually just use super glue or epoxy just to plant these things on the reef, and it's particularly off of Florida, they're doing a great job of doing that. So, have reefs met their match? Coral reefs are definitely challenged by climate change. Warming's gonna continue, we know coral bleaching events will continue, but there is a capacity for a lot of these corals to adapt to that. We're trying to determine now, can they adapt fast enough? There are some thoughts that the branching corals are going to get hit more than the big head corals. We're still trying to figure all that out, how that's going to work. We also know that ocean acidification will impact the ability of coral reefs to recover because of that recruitment problem with the things, and that the reef structure will be attacked. But doesn't kill the corals directly, the adult corals, so there's some hope there. There's a lot we can do to clean up the challenge. To lessen the challenge, we can clean up all those other stressors. We can have better conservation planning, and we can find creative ways to grow new corals. And so that's it. And I just want to thank again John and all of you guys for coming and enduring the talk. Really appreciate your coming. And I think there's wine waiting, right?
But quite